You've got it tuned to listener-powered KEXP, 90.3 FM Seattle and KEXP.org. Words fail me. I'm so excited. Ladies and gentlemen, it's Owen Pallett. Soldiers Rock by Owen Pallett here on KEXP, Where the Music Matters. That's from his new album, In Conflict. Can we hear another one?
Yeah. As many as you want.
Well, no, don't give me that much liberty.
Thanks. You ready? Across the overpass, it starts to rain. We leave my father's house enveloped in flames. Well, how and where were you to stop the fire? I know no satisfaction, only no desire. Tender from the summer sun, listening as we try to make each other come. The silhouette is scattering our traces. The rising flame reflects across our faces. Owen Pallett in the KEXP studios. Thanks so much for joining us tonight, Owen. It's my pleasure. The highlight of my week, honestly. I'm so happy to be here.
Mine too. I've been looking forward to this a great deal. So you're on tour of North America, and I think I get a kick out of this. You're playing with one of your opening bands as well.
Yeah. Why not? Well,
why, actually, is the question I was wondering.
Maybe a couple of reasons. Like, firstly, the reason I asked him to come out on tour was because he's an old friend of mine. Not an old friend, I guess a kind of a newer friend of mine, but I had been working on his record and I totally fell in love with his music, and I thought it would be a really good pairing for, to have him out. And, but also, I mean, I think it's really important to have a good relationship with your support acts, you know? Like, I mean, I just hear so many. It's like if I hear about a band, you know, who treats their support act well, it's hard for me to really hate that band. I heard stories, you know, about Kings of Leon. You know, Kings of Leon treat their support band so well, I heard, from bands that had supported them, that I kind of, like, can't find myself to really say anything negative about them. Well, not that I could in the first place, but...
No, and nor
when you hear that, you're just kind of like, oh, if they're good people, then... Yeah.
So the message then to everyone out there in listener land is, if you're going to see Owen, make sure you get there extra early so you can see Foxes in Fiction, because they sound great and Owen is playing with them.
And Avi Buffalo, too, is from L.A. They're going to be on the West Coast tour as well, which is really exciting.
And they have a fantastic new album out on Sub Pop.
Yeah, very exciting.
Speaking of fantastic new albums, I'm in love with your new record, In Conflict. I know you put a lot of thought into working on the lyrics for the records, but I understand you took a slightly different approach or approaches to working on the lyrics this time. Is that true?
Yeah, I guess so. They kind of came out the same way, but rather than cloak what I was trying to say in some kind of a fictional accoutrement, I just put myself in first person and, you know, put myself kind of as the protagonist in a way. Does that make sense? I starred in the film. Yeah. So, but yeah, a lot of the time when I was making it too, I was kind of thinking a lot about mental illness, and a lot of the songs were kind of dealing with different versions of that, you know, and varying states of mind.
So it's funny because I read this quote from you, featured prominently in your press bio, of course. The record is meant to approach insanity in a positive way. What a lot of people might qualify as insanity, I think of as being in the creative flow.
Well, yeah, that's kind of the point. I mean, you're also only quoting the first half of that sentence, because it goes on to say that it's not preferable, but it's, you know, an equal state of being. But yeah, it is exactly that I've started to notice a great deal of connections between my own creative activity and my own crazy. And I was interested in pursuing that. I mean, I already kind of had figured that out on Heartland, but this one I was more interested in kind of connecting those dots to other people and other situations.
Does it get scarier or easier once you've accepted that, to sort of have the protracted periods of really being in the flow of the insanity, as it were?
Do you mean in the actual songwriting process or now that the record's out?
In the actual songwriting process.
It does get kind of scary sometimes, but generally the actual writing process is when you're in the manic state, you know, and I'll finish a song and I'll be so excited about it that I will, like, call all my friends and be emailing lyrics and pulling my phone out at parties and being like, listen to this, I'm playing it from the iPhone speaker. I don't care what you think of that. You know what I mean? There's a point where you've just got to be like, if you're friends with me, this is something you're going to have to put up with, is me being excited about what I do.
Yeah.
And there's no shame in that, you know? There's a lot. I feel like there's a lot of shame on the internet, and I read about it too, you know? It's just like when you see somebody kind of, like, tweeting about their new record, there's this, you know, part of you that's just kind of like, oh, how sad and desperate that person is to have to tweet about this piece of music. But, you know, I've stopped feeling that way. I feel extremely encouraging towards, you know, both consumers and producers.
Speaking of producers, you have a super special guest on the record. Did you actually meet Eno?
Yeah. No, he invited the three of us to play his festival in Kristiansand that he was curating. It's called the Punkt Festival, and they had David Sylvian curate the year before, and then Eno was curating it. This would have been 2011. So we flew over and played a set, and we were right on after Ben Frost, actually, and we played really well, and he was really impressed. And so I ran into him a couple more times after that. And one of those times was at the Kitchen. There was a gala that was honoring him, and the Kitchen had asked me to play because they knew that Eno and I kind of had, you know, I mean, to say mutual respect for each other is kind of, how could it possibly be mutual, you know? But, you know, I am enthralled by his music, and he, you know, is aware of mine. So I got on stage and played, and afterwards I asked if he would sing backing vocals because I knew he was really into that. And so he did.
Well, and it went smoothly and seems to have been delightful for all concerned.
He was probably one of the most active participants I've ever had. Like, he was just voraciously, you know, consuming the tracks and coming up with incredible ideas, and they were all very, very out, like very strong, hard ideas. Like, there was nothing half, no half ass. It was full ass. Yeah.
Why don't we hear some more music?
Okay.
Please.
You got it. Thank you.
to break across the river and a moon faced boy. Would you write a speaking part for me? A part that puts me somewhere between the elevated road and the water. It don't get better. Upon the side of our union. And if your mother doesn't answer, then give me a call. Here's my number, 854-784.
The Secret Seven by Owen Pallett on KEXP. Okay, since many of our listeners are in Seattle and I'm a gay man and you're a gay man, I thought it was sort of important that we talk about this song. Can you tell our listeners a little bit about the impetus behind this song? What inspired you to write it?
In the end of 2010, when Tyler Clementi committed suicide and Dan Savage began the It Gets Better project, I felt like there was I felt a somewhat divergent response to the entire project, and I felt a little helpless about it. The helplessness kind of stemmed from the fact that my own experience with mental illness and recurrent suicidal ideation has not allayed itself or abated as I have entered the middle class. So, well, the lower middle, like middle class musician, lower class world. But as I've kind of like my life has changed and I've become quote unquote happier. Mm-hmm. The illness is not abated. And I found that the videos of people telling me, you know, how great their lives were, in fact, made me feel more isolated and made me feel more excluded from, you know, happy adulthood. So, but I mean, the project was so beautiful and affected people so in such a profoundly positive way that I didn't want to, you know, outright say this is not a good thing or this is not my experience. I wanted to kind of create a different response, a positive response, and so I wrote this song about it.
So it's kind of like a qualifier and an invitation to discussion. It's saying, you know, yes, you may grow up and you may become more content being gay and some things may be accepted, and that doesn't necessarily negate these other things that may be going on.
Exactly. I mean, there was a lot of scapegoating, I felt, that towards bullying and towards sexual orientation. And I think it's important to recognize, you know, the correlations between these things. But ultimately, I think it's important to, you know, also remember that it's often mental illness. It's often treatable. It's often, you know, needs to be talked about as being from the sickness, to acknowledge what the problem is, as opposed to sublimate the blame upon, you know, your bullier or upon your orientation. You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
So, but, you know, this is all just discussion. And I mean, I just wanted to put forward a kind of a positive response as opposed to, you know, trolling the internet, talking about how it's, you know, the program is bullshit, you know, because I don't actually feel that way. I just had a specific response and wanted to act on it.
And you actually list your own phone number at the end. Have you gotten phone calls from people who want to discuss that in depth?
No, not discussion so much as just like kind of like, hey, how are you? Oftentimes there are people who I know who have come to shows and, you know, I know their names, or sometimes some strangers who then I've met later. You know, I always try and maintain a very hands-on sort of public you know, persona, and trying to be very available towards the people that come to my show. So it didn't feel like an unnatural thing for me. So far, I haven't gotten any crank calls. It's all been positives.
Good. Yeah. I understand that you've prepared a selection from your back catalog from us.
Yeah. Well, you know, there's all the new songs, but these the old songs kind of sound like they've been injected with some, you know, nitroglycerin and exploded in a parking lot. So okay. I kind of wanted to play a couple of them.
Well, let's hear it.
Of the Prince of Buzz, can't wait until you can't wait till you unsubscribe. I'll be your lonely scribe. But what if they like it? Lux in a canary with your accordion until we can our love, we can get along. One tree almighty did young, but one tree won't break us down. a VCR. If we put our hearts in 20,000 tiny jars, they'd never leave their homes. We can get along. We can get along. Montreal, mighty dits young. Up Montreal won't break us down. Tried to keep the crowds away. Tried to keep the crowds away.
Owen Pallett on KEXP, Where the Music Matters. I understand as a special treat you've prepared a fifth selection for us.
Well, yeah, just because, you know, our songs are reliant upon these loops that I have to, you know, well, you're seeing it happen. And sometimes they can kind of go awry, so I wanted to make a bonus track just in case you wanted to cut one.
Or play all five.
Well, so far, I don't know. You guys make the decision. We'll be right back.
Urban Palette on KEXP 90.3 FM Seattle and KEXP.org. Wow. Thank you, Owen.
Thank you, Kurt. Thanks for having us.
Thank you, Matt. Thank you, Robbie. I'm DJ El Toro. This is KEXP.
Discover new music at listener-powered KEXP.org.